Good afternoon, everybody.
Is it still afternoon, Mr.
Stephen?
No, let's call it evening. Thank you very kindly for coming along. This is essentially the last in a series of lectures that the University of Newcastle has been putting on, called the Practice Matters lectures. And this evening we've got quite a luminary of industrial design in Australia, so it's an easy introduction for me to make. From industrial design myself, I would like to think that we kept the best presentation till the end. This is the last one for the year, so thank you very kindly, Bryn, for coming on it. I've just got a few things that are important to us to understand and also important in the eyes of the University of Newcastle. So before I formally introduce Brendan, just allow me to say a few words here. The University of Newcastle respectfully acknowledges the traditional custodians, the Awabakal people, on whose traditional land this town hall is now located. I'd also like to say a few words of thanks for our sponsors for this lecture series throughout the year. We've had a range of sponsors, our gold sponsors being BKA Architecture and CSRT, our silver sponsors in the form of the Hunter Development Centre, the City of Newcastle, of course, for the venue that they've made available to us throughout the year, and the Gisa Japanese Restaurant, and Mira Park Wines for their catering sponsorship. It's greatly appreciated. And lastly, but far from leastly, the Architecture Foundation for its hands-on support for the last 12 months. It's been wonderful. So if I may now get to our honoured guest, bear with me. This is both, it's a kind of a double-edged sword. It's easy to introduce somebody like Brendan because there's so much to say. And it's also just a little bit testing because you realise when you compare this to yourself, I'm a little bit underwhelming. Hang in there. Small story, I'm prone to these things. I was recently introduced overseas, and it was, you must hear this all the time, do your own biography read out to you. I was halfway through it and I was thinking, who is this wanker? And it was actually me, so hang in there. Dr. Brendan Gien, my apologies, that's the second time I've done it, is the founder and CEO of Good Design Australia and the chair of Australia's Good Design Awards, the oldest and most prestigious design award program in Australia, with its origins going back to the Industrial Design Council of Australia, established in 1958. In 2015, Dr. Gien was inaugurated as a Senator of the World Design Organisation, formerly the International Council of Societies of Industrial Design, and is the first Australian ever to hold this position. Under his leadership, he spearheaded the strategic transformation of the organisation, resulting in a new name, a new vision and mission, and a new global definition for industrial design. Through his work with the World Design Organisation, he co-founded the World Design Impact Prize to honour the industrial design-driven projects that make a positive impact to our social, economic, cultural and environmental quality of life. So that's quite a big deal. He studied mechanical engineering at the University of Newcastle, and we're even more proud to say he graduated with a Bachelor of Industrial Design from University of Newcastle, so we claim him as one of our own, albeit a thin claim. He holds a PhD in Environmental Design from the University of Canberra's Design and Architecture School. Brendan was made a Fellow of the Design Institute of Australia for his service to the design profession in Australia and is a board member of the Shanghai City Government's International Creative City Advisory Board. He also sits on the International Advisory Board for Srishti's Institute of Art, Design and Technology in India, and has participated as a jury member for some of the most prestigious design awards in the world. Brendan was made a design ambassador to Japan, an international design advocacy role organised by the Japan Institute of Design Promotion, and is currently an adjunct professor of industrial design at the University of Canberra. With the formality aside, with such a sparkling backdrop, may I ask you to join with me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Brendan Gien.
Thank you very, very much for having me up here in Newcastle to talk to you guys. I will talk about design at the drop of a hat because it's a subject that is incredibly important to me. I'm very, very passionate about it. And I've been very, very fortunate over the last 20 years in the sense that my career has taken a pretty weird journey. From not necessarily practicing industrial design, but being on the promotion side of design. So I'm hoping that my presentation today is going to inspire you. I've been asked to talk for 45 minutes. I don't think I've actually given a presentation for that long. So bear with me, I haven't even timed it, so we could be here for a few hours. We could be here for 15 or 20 minutes. But hopefully by the end of it, you will be inspired and have an idea of the incredible journey that I've been on over the last 20 years. So not really knowing who I was presenting to, a lot of what I'm going to say today is you probably do understand anyway, because from what I've seen, many of you are industrial design students, and so I'm going to skip through some of the stuff so we can get to some of the better stuff. The one thing that I find fascinating when I meet people who don't necessarily understand what industrial design is or what an industrial designer does, I almost have to start from scratch. I have to start from the basics and say, well, if you look around you in the room that you're sitting in, every single thing has been designed. It may not have been designed by an industrial designer, it may not have been designed very well, but everything apart from the trees that grow out of the ground have been designed by someone. The roads we drive on, the buildings we work in, the toothbrush that you use to brush your teeth this morning, if you brush your teeth, has been designed by someone. And when you start to kind of open that conversation up with someone, they kind of go, wow, okay, that's kind of a different way of looking at the world, because everything around us didn't just drop out of thin air. It is actually an object of design. Unfortunately, design has a bit of a bad name as well, because you see objects like this. Does anyone know what this is? Yeah, you've got one. Yeah. I bought one for my brother for his second wedding, I think, and I have to say it's an absolute piece of junk. To non-design audiences, they have no idea what it is, and when they sort of see that, they go, yeah, you know, it's a lemon squeezer. And, you know, that's great. Philip Stark is an amazing designer, and he designed some incredible stuff. But I'd argue that's art, and it's not design. And there's that wonderful saying that art doesn't have to work, art doesn't have to function. Design does. Design has to function. It has to perform a proper function. And this thing, you've got one, how often have you actually used it?
Once,
yeah. And I'm sure that when you have, yeah, it just spills everywhere. It's kind of like a nice gimmick, and it ends up in a shelf somewhere. And even worse, it probably ends up in a rubbish tip. And that, to me, is the real downside of design. There's a lot of crap. There's an absolute lot of stuff that just ends up on rubbish tips. And a big part of what we try and advocate for is that's not really the sort of design that we should be encouraging people to do. So Philip Stark, I've met him, he's quite a character. He'll probably hate me for using that as a bad example of design. But there are many, many more ones that are worse than that. Anybody heard of the app called Pooper? This is an amazing app, right? Solving a huge problem. So you get to take your dog for a walk, your dog does a poo, and you're too lazy to pick up that poo, you actually log where that poo's been dropped, and you can pay somebody to come and pick it up. Right? It's been launched in the US, and you kind of think to yourself, I mean, the technology that goes on behind that is phenomenal. It uses GPS tracking, it's got a whole, you know, e-commerce system built into the back of it. You're paying someone to pick up your dog's poo. Now, is that good design? I'd sort of say no. And how do we encourage people to kind of think of technology and think of design in a much, much different way, and saying this is not a problem that I think deserves to be solved? We talk a hell of a lot about the ability to measure design's impact. It's one of the biggest challenges that I see in the corporate world, when you're up there trying to argue for a dollar spend that goes into investing in a design project, and people go, why should I pay for a designer to help me, you know, design this product? Why is it important? And there's that old saying, you know, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. If you can't manage it, well, you can't improve it. So there's been a lot of studies done in trying to actually get an economic value around design. I like this one. It's a few years old, out of the Design Management Institute in Boston, in the US, where they looked at 150 companies that were using design strategically, and compared those companies to the FTSE 100, and found over a 10-year period, so not just a one-year period, a 10-year period, that these companies outperformed the stock market by 200%. You know. So again, it's a small little bit of evidence. It's a long way to go. There's a lot of work that's been done out of the UK Design Council as well. If you guys haven't looked at the UK Design Council website, I'd encourage you to do that. It's a brilliant site, and they've got some incredible data there around the value of design as well. You can't do a design presentation without mentioning Apple. And you know, Apple's not the only organisation in the world that gets design, but I can tell you one thing, they are the one organisation that got it quite a while ago, and are now recognised as one of the most valuable companies in the world. I did a quick check, I think this was as of yesterday, their market capitalisation is $585 billion. One of the most valuable companies on the planet. And I argue black and blue that if you take the small little design department that is at the heart of Apple, if you take those guys out, Apple ceases to exist. That value goes to zero. And you know, it is to me an example of a company that without a doubt uses design as part of its DNA in everything that they do, not just the products that they design, the packaging, the branding, the websites, the entire ecosystem around Apple has been very, very meticulously designed, and an amazing showcase for what design can do to a company. I'm sure you guys have heard of Nest. The interesting story around Nest is that there's a guy called Tony Fadell, who used to be part of Apple's design team. He went off on his own and designed a thermostat. You know, these are horrible little clunky devices that sit in your house, and brought that same design ethos to a fairly mundane product. The user interface in this thing, has anyone seen the Nest product in real? I saw it in the US about a year ago, and it is absolutely, it's like an Apple iPhone. It's just, you know, everything about it is so beautifully designed. The user interface is just incredible. It learns with you, so it learns your preferences, what temperature you like in the afternoon, what temperature you like first thing in the morning. Incredibly intuitive. The amazing thing about this is that because of design, because of someone like Tony Fadell, who had that absolute intricate understanding of how design should be positioned in a product like this, it was bought by Google for $3.2 billion. And you don't hear that a lot, you know, that's not million, that's $1 billion. And Google just snapped it up, and as people, you know, are now being saying in the media, it's a way for Google to get into your homes and to understand how they can, you know, start connecting devices in your house as well. But again, a fantastic example of design really, really paying off. We hear this term, design thinking. As a designer, I'm sure I'm not alone, that it drives me nuts. You know, in the last 3-4 years, probably 5 years, it's just been this this term that you see in management consultants, and everyone's a design thinker. You know, you sort of see these guys coming out of MBA schools and business schools, and they just add the word design thinking next to their resume. And it's, you know, it's great because it's actually put design on the map, I think, in the corporate world, but at the same time, it's also, I think, created a lot of confusion about what actual design is. You guys would know who, you know, you're out there studying design, you know that it is actually a process. It's not a little magic bit of sprinkle that you place on a product or a process, but it is a very methodical process. I love this little diagram out of the NN group, and they just sort of break it down as well. For the non-designers in the room, I kind of go through this step by step, and you know, that ability to empathise, I think, is one of the most important things that a designer brings to any project. To be able to kind of go, well, we're designing a pram for a mother, and she's got two other kids, and this pram must be X, Y, and Z. You need to jump into that world of that consumer. You need to be able to empathise as much as possible. If you're designing mountaineering equipment, you almost need to become a mountaineer. If you're designing photography equipment, you need to become a photographer. And that's the most critical thing, I think, to be able to really start to think like a designer. The ability to define the problem, you know, there's this beautiful saying, Einstein was given this question: if he had 24 hours, 1 hour to live, of the end of the world. If the world was going to end in 1 hour, what would he do? So he'd spend 59 minutes actually making sure that he understood the question, and one minute, you know, trying to solve it. And I think that's just so telling about, again, designers ask all those really stupid questions because they're trying to get to the heart of what the real problem is. And I see that in the corporate world a lot. You see companies going down one particular route and actually solving the wrong problem. They've got to kind of come back and have a very good understanding of the problem that they're actually trying to solve. The ideation bit, as designers, you know, that's the fun bit. It's where you get to throw out crazy ideas, and it's all about generating as many ideas as possible, as quickly as possible. When I was in, I think it was in third year industrial design, I'll never forget this project we were given, and it was to we had a week to come up with 100 concepts for a clothesline, 100. Given A3 pieces of paper, landscape, and you had to sketch out 100 different concepts for an eye. And we all laughed. We just thought, what an absolutely ridiculous project. You know, we had a week to do it. But it wasn't so much about coming up with these finished, you know, beautifully rendered irons. It was about getting our heads in that space of just generating lots and lots of ideas. And I'll never forget, because for me, the first 30 or 40 were really easy. The next, when I got to about from 50 to 60, it was almost impossible. I didn't even know. I thought I was going crazy. How do you come up with another concept for an iron? But then something magic happens when you get to 70 and 80. You stop thinking about irons. You start thinking about ironing boards. You start thinking about clothing. You start thinking about clothing that doesn't crease. And then you start thinking about, why the hell are we even wearing clothes? So that process of ideation, I think, is just, you know, it's one of the strengths that designers bring to the table. And then, as we know, prototyping, testing, prototyping, breaking, making, you know, that ability to get into a workshop and quickly knock something up and make it and go, that failed, that's good, we learned something from it. Testing, going back to the consumer, to your testing group, and getting feedback and putting that back into the process as well, and then finally the implementation part of it. So it's, you know, when I talk to the corporate sector about this, and you sort of see them all nodding, they're going, yeah, well, it's not, design isn't this hoodoo guru kind of thing. It is actually a very methodical process, and it can be applied to a product, it can be applied to a process, to a system, to someone who has a fish and chip shop, you know, and say, how do you improve my business? Go through these steps, work with a designer, and you can actually see that it can add value, you know, regardless of what the product is, or the process is, or the system is. There's a nice little diagram, I'm sure you guys may have seen it. I've adapted this out of IDEO, where they talk about these three areas of design coming together. And to me, it really does summarise what designers do in terms of being able to ask these very, very basic questions around design. Think of the Apple iPhone. If the technology wasn't there, well, it wouldn't work, you know, so it wouldn't be feasible. If you had to pay $5,500 for an iPhone, well, no one's going to buy it. So it's not viable from a business perspective. And then, you know, again, from a people point of view, making sure that it's desirable, making sure that whatever it is you've designed has that desirability factor as well. And when you get all of those three right, absolutely perfect, they talk about that experience innovation, you know, when you pick up a product and it just works and it just makes you smile. We had a judge 1 year from the US, Sean Berryman, and she's a very respected UX designer, user experience designer, and we're interviewing her, and she had this beautiful quote, you know, and it's like, joy is not accidental. And I love that, because when you pick up a product and you actually see someone smile, that's not an accidental thing. It doesn't happen by accident. Someone's spent, you know, years and years meticulously thinking about every single aspect of that product to make it work. Design-led innovation. This is, again, one of those things that just drives me up the wall. When we had Turnbull come out last year and talk about how we're going to do the ideas nation and I don't know what else he used, the ideas boom, and it's all going to be about innovation. You notice he's gone really quiet on that. You know, we don't even see what the hell's happened. And I think it failed because he didn't talk about design-led innovation. It's all about innovation. If you walk up to, you know, I use my fish and chip shop friend, say, you need to be more innovative. You know, you've got a great business here, but you need to be more innovative. First thing he's going to turn around and say, well, how do you expect me to do that? Or any business for that matter, it's really hard to get people to be innovative without any parameters. And what design does, it creates those parameters. It creates that process around innovation. And again, you know, bringing it back to an example, if you've got a brilliant idea, that spark of creativity, a new product, a new piece of technology, to try and turn that into an innovation, to try and turn that into a commercially successful, viable product. If you don't use design, it's just going to be another bunch of wires, another piece of technology that will never get anywhere. So we're desperately advocating non-stop. We've met with Turnbull, I think he gets it, to start changing the narrative around design and call it design-led innovation. If we can become a design-led country, then we're killing it. You know, but if we can become an innovative country, every other country in the world is trying to be innovative. You know, they're all trying to do it. If we can be design-led, I think that will change the game. So watch this space. I love this. Warren, you were telling me you used to work for IBM. This is an internal memo that was sent to all staff at IBM by the president of IBM at the time, 1966, so well before Apple. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but the first line, you know, good design is good business. And it strikes me that this whole notion of design has been around for a long time. IBM obviously didn't take it as seriously as Apple did, but the interesting thing around IBM now is they're employing more designers than what they are software electronics engineers, which is kind of cool. You know, they understand that they can't really just be a technology business alone. They've got to be able to try and disseminate that technology, and design is a way to do it. From our point of view at Good Design Australia, I refer to us as a design promotion body. That's what we do. We promote the value of design to business, to industry, to government, and most importantly, to the general public. And it's really, really hard because design is invisible. You know, I say that all the time. I notice it when 9 times out of 10, you only notice it when it doesn't work. You see someone interact with a kettle, and it's like, who the hell designed this? Because the button's in the wrong place, or the thing doesn't work, and then straight away you blame the designer, or you blame the person who actually made that. But the good part of design is it goes completely unnoticed. You know, when you flick on your light switch and the lights magically turn on, you don't think about all the amazing things that happen to turn those lights on. You just go, they're on. And that makes it really, really hard for us in terms of promoting good design, because people kind of just go, well, isn't that what all products should do? They should just work. So it's been an area that we've been very, very focused on for the last, me personally, for the last 20 years. I've had the incredible fortune of being associated with the Good Design Awards. As Warren said in the introduction, one of the things I'm most proud of is that our awards program is actually one of the oldest in the world. Japan was created a year before us in 1957. They have the Japanese GMAR, the Japanese Good Design Award. There's IF and Red Dot were created a few years back as well. But to me, that's probably one of the most valuable things about our awards program, because I think that they not only tell a story of design in this country, they also tell a story of our own culture as well. A short little timeline there, in the 1960s, Prince Philip himself, the Duke of Edinburgh, established this prize called the Prince Philip Prize for Australian Design, well before my time. But we've got all this incredible black and white footage of Prince coming to Australia and awarding this incredible honour to an Australian company every single year. Before it, I think in the 70s, it then changed its name and became the Australian Design Award. The awards used to be televised on ABC, national television. That's picture of Ita Buttrose there in the 70s, presenting on ABC. The Australia 2 Wing Keel receiving the Design Award, right through the most iconic products, the Hills Hoist, the Victor Lawnmower. So we've just got this incredible archive of stuff that I treasure, because I think, it, as I said, it not only tells a story about design, but it tells a story about Australia as well. In 2008, we celebrated our 50th anniversary and opened up the awards internationally. That changed the game, because all of a sudden we weren't just comparing Ford against Holden and Holden against Ford. We were comparing, you know, Australian design against an international standard. And in 2010, I established Good Design Australia as a separate independent organisation, and the awards used to be run by Standards Australia, which is our national standards body, and since 2010 it's been run independently under the banner of Good Design Australia, and it's been brilliant. You know, the standard of submissions just absolutely blows me away every single year. We just get some of the most amazing stuff entered, and we've opened up the categories not only to industrial design but to architecture. We have an architectural design category, a business model design category, so this is actually talking about how businesses use design, digital design, communications design, a category for social innovation, how is design being used at that very societal level to solve some really, really big problems. How do you get homeless people off the street? How do you use a design methodology to try and do that? Here's a short little video, and I hope it works, that just we produced a few years ago and played at our awards night. I think it just perfectly sums up what we're about. I just want to talk a little bit about how design, and particularly industrial design, has changed over the years. For those of you who know, you know, the term industrial design came out of the Industrial Revolution. We worked out how to make things, mass produce things, and make many of them. And consumers, you know, at the time were like not really satisfied with one version of something. They wanted multiple versions of something. And this term really grew out of that. A process of saying, how do we design for mass production? How do we design multiple versions of things that can be produced, you know, on a mass scale? And you know, nothing really much changed for many, many years. I'd say probably even really over the last 20 years, it was all around this notion of how do you design stuff to be mass produced. And then, as I said, Apple came along, and it was all about how do we use design to make products more appealing to consumers? How do we use design to not only design the product, but design the entire ecosystem in which that product resides in, and use it, you know, to generate sales and attract more customers? It's been really, I think, over the last, I'd say, 10, 11 years, where you're seeing companies investing in design at that strategic level. The companies such as Deloitte and PwC, even startups like Uber and Airbnb, all about design. It's all about how they use design, not only in the physical product that they're designing, but at that strategic level. I use the example of Deloitte. I know the lady very well, Maureen Thurston, who's from the US. She's an industrial designer. She was the very first industrial designer employed by Deloitte. It was an accounting firm. Helping them improve their service delivery from a design perspective. You speak to her, you know, never in a million years would she ever think that she'd be working for an accounting firm. She was designing, you know, toothbrushes and consumer products. The really, really interesting thing that's happening, I guess, I'd say again over the last 2 to 3 years, is that you're seeing design being used at that government level to shape policy. Helsinki as a city in Finland, as an example, have just employed their very first chief design officer. What an amazing thing for a city to have a chief design officer, just as if it was Apple or any other company, employing a designer to have that holistic approach of how a city operates. The really, really, I guess, aspiring part of where all this is headed is this aspect of this aspirational view of design for a better world, design for sustainability and prosperity for our planet. And again, it's an aspirational view that designers, I think, should have, because at the end of the day, our world is kind of a little bit crazy at the moment, and there's some pretty big challenges that need to be solved. And designers, industrial designers, can't do it alone. An interesting, I hope this animation works, and I'm sorry you probably can't see that, but where that circle is, this was out of the American Museum of Natural History. I got this a couple of days ago, just to try and illustrate, if you're looking at our world as an object of design and how crazy things have actually got. It took us 200,000 years to reach 1 billion people in terms of population. And where that circle is, that's sort of just where the Industrial Revolution started to kick in, right? And that was only 200 years from a billion people to 7.2 billion people. So you can imagine the kind of pressure that that's putting on our planet. More alarmingly is that it's putting an enormous pressure on our cities. So by 2050, I think it's like 9.5 our population is predicted to be around 9.5 billion people, right? And 75% of those people are going to be living in our cities. So you imagine what that's going to do to our urban infrastructure, to you know our city services. There's more and more people who are urbanising cities, huge population, you know, going into our cities. So what can be done about that? And again, it's not an industrial design challenge, it's a design challenge for engineers, for architects, for urban planners and the like. And I think that it is, you know, this point in time right now that we need to start talking about this rather than talking about beautiful kettles and toasters and fridges. So I want to share with you a little bit of my journey at an international stage. So that was a photo taken a very long time ago. I Good Design Australia was a member of ICSID, which is the International Council of Societies of Industrial Design. It's a bit of a mouthful. And we were, almost always at the outskirts. You know, this is the United Nations for Design. They have a General Assembly every 2 years. They have 140 member organisations representing every single corner of the planet. And I actually took a bet with one of my colleagues that I should run for the board, which was kind of a bit of a joke, because as I was saying to you, Warren, the average person on the board had either no hair or grey hair, and for a young Aussie to come along and have a crack was, I thought I'd just be laughed out of the room. But I obviously said something right. I was elected by one vote. I snuck in and made it onto the board of directors, and you asked me what the first 2 years were like. I literally just sat there and didn't say a word. I was surrounded by, you know, there were 11 members on the board of directors, and then me, and the most incredible group of people that I have ever met in my life. From every part of the planet, every single region of our world was represented. And I literally spent the first 2 years learning, and then re-ran for the board for the following term and got re-elected, which was amazing. So it was another new, fresh group of people that came on board. And noticed that the narrative around design was really focused around this notion of design for a better world. This organisation needed to be redesigned itself. And they were struggling to do that. Because industrial design was still stuck in this old dark age world of designing products and not really trying to lift out of that space and be more aspirational. So I was fortunate to work with a board during the second term, and really I think that's where I started to find my own stride to say, let's be more confident, let's actually talk about design in this new world. Let's look at some of the biggest challenges in our world and see how design can actually try and help solve those. Here's a summary of what that really looked like at a very, very high level. It was all about trying to identify what the biggest global challenges on our planet were and how can design actually help try and solve those. I'm not going to solve every single one of them. There's no way in hell that's going to happen, but there certainly is an opportunity for design to get stuck into most of these. Energy, how do we actually design more energy efficient products? Water salinity, how do we make sure that there's enough clean water to drink for 9 billion people on our planet? Pollution, the whole thing around climate change, how do we make sure that design, when you're designing something, and as the global body for design, we have a position on that. Traffic congestion, designing for an aging population. Every single country around the world has this challenge. The refugee crisis. You might think, yeah, right, how can design actually help solve that problem? I'm going to show you a little bit later on. Garbage. One of the biggest problems I think that designers are responsible for. Everything we design ends up in a rubbish tip. How do we live with that? How do we try and change our view around how design is positioned? And of course, food. Let me just show you a very short video that, again, tries to articulate what this is all about.
In the 50s, our world was a different place, with different problems, different challenges. The post-industrial world gave rise to social and economic progress, and urbanization changed patterns of consumption that fueled market globalization. Industrial design revolutionized consumer goods and became the symbol of modern progress. People everywhere welcomed more desirable products and better lifestyles. Fast forward 60 years, and our world faces a new set of challenges. Overconsumption has contributed to issues such as pollution, traffic congestion, the depletion of our natural resources, climate change, food and water shortages, as well as poor health care and sanitation. By 2050, more than 9.6 billion people will share our planet, creating even more pressure on cities and more demand for our precious resources. Just as our world has changed, so has the world of industrial design. It has evolved and is now a transdisciplinary profession that harnesses creativity to solve problems and improve people's quality of life. At the heart of it, industrial design provides a more optimistic way of looking at our world, a perspective where challenges are seen as opportunity. After all, through the eyes of design, there's the potential to unlock trillions of dollars in commercial return, social benefits, and environmental efficiencies. It's about the shift from what's the problem to what's possible. And designing a better world is possible if everyone in the global design community believes in this shared aspirational vision. Through collaboration, we can do more than just imagine a better world. We can make it a reality by leading the way in designing it. We've laid the groundwork with our international initiatives. World Design Capital, World Design Impact Prize, InterDesign, World Industrial Design Day, and our World Design Partner Program are already in place to showcase the problem-solving potential of design. By aligning our strengths, we can pave the way for an exciting new era for our industry. We can make design globally relevant, widely effective, and give it the power to transform lives. Through the lens of industrial design, the future is bright, but the time is now to put human needs above consumer demands and elevate design as a catalyst for positive change. Together, we can take industrial design to the next level. Together, we can design a better world.
So one of the first things that I did when I took over as president of ICSID, which is the last 2 years of my term, and this is almost an embarrassing thing to admit, but we had this definition for industrial design that was last defined in 1972, and I brought this to the attention of the board that I was president of, and I said, this is our starting point. We need to completely redefine the profession. If we're going to change the direction of ICSID, we're going to change our vision, our mission, and the trajectory in which design is headed, we also need a completely new definition. And it struck me as something that was just, why hasn't anyone ever, you know, even addressed this before? The definition that was there, that was created in the 1970s, was pretty good, but all it spoke about was manufacturing and product design in the sense that we all understand it. It didn't really talk about this problem-solving capacity that design has. Didn't mention words such as strategy and improving people's quality of life. As a project, I think it was probably one of the most incredible things that I was involved with, because we couldn't just snap our fingers and come up with a new definition. We had to consult and consult and consult, and we went back to the design process. We actually said, look, let's design this, and went through, we tried to connect with the global design industry as much as we could. We started up a microsite for the new definition for industrial design. There were 650,000 responses to that. And in the process of trying to condense all of that and make sense of it was the secretariat in Montreal had to do. And we ended up with this definition here, which I think is pretty damn close to what I think the industrial design profession should be described as. And as the global body for the profession, that's how the whole world basically, you know, they go to ICSID, they go to ICSID's website and say, this is what industrial design is. So I'm incredibly proud of that, just as a project and a group of people that I was fortunate enough to work with. That was voted on, it was unanimously accepted at the General Assembly last year, and that is now our new global definition for industrial design. Sorry, there's a few videos here, but I find them kind of cool because you get bored of hearing from me all the time. The next video is another little piece that I helped produce to really try and push this whole notion of changing the organisation, changing its direction, and changing its name. ICSID is a pretty big mouthful, and I used to come back from every single trip that I did overseas and, you know, tell people that, oh wow, I'm the president of ICSID. And I was like, what is that? It's like, well, it's the International Council of Societies of Industrial Design. And by the time I got to, you know, halfway through, they'd fall asleep and not even care. And we proposed, as well, of all these radical changes, we also put on the table a new name for the organisation, something that, you know, I said, if I can't explain it to my five-year-old boy, then we're missing the game, and we ended up calling it the World Design Organisation. So part of convincing our members, who are very old-fashioned, was again for me to reach out to as many industrial designers around the world for them to buy into this. And this video is not the entire video, it's just a part of it that really tries to capture the spirit of everybody else agreeing with this new direction. So have a look. Single person who voted this down, and somewhere in there is me in the middle. I think I had my eyes closed because I was just bloody exhausted, but we got it through. So ICSID will be called the World Design Organization. Here's a short little clip of what that branding will look like. It will be official on the 1st of January next year, because we had to go through a whole bunch of changes to make that real. So here it is. believe it or not, the entire logo is based on that little blue line, which is the idea of, that's the first thing that designers do is draw. That branding will be revealed on the 1st of Jan next year, which will be great to see. So I'm just going to use the last little part of this presentation to talk to you about some amazing examples of design for a better world, because there's one thing to talk about it, and there's actually another thing to actually show you some really tangible examples of where design is actually making a big impact on our world. And I call them design problems worth solving. For those of you who may have read, there's a big problem with bees. Populations around the world, bee populations are declining. They're attributing it to a whole bunch of things, even the increased use of insecticides. And that is a serious problem. It may not be that a few bees die, but if our entire bee population ceases to exist, we are no longer on this planet, because they keep everything going. And the next project is, I think in my time, probably being one of the most incredible design projects I've ever seen in my life, and I thought it was a nice one to start off with. Again, it's not going to solve the problem of bees vanishing from our planet, but it's certainly going to have a good crack at it. This is the problem, right? So to be a beekeeper, this is kind of the picture that you're going to be looking at. Whole bunch of bees flying around, you need to be an expert in it, you need to have all the right equipment, you need to know what you're doing, and it's a really, really tough thing, quite complex, and you're looking after these beautiful little bees, and then trying to extract the honey from one of those beehives is even more complex. So I won't show you a video, but it's, you have to smoke the bees out, lift these canisters out, and it's a pretty complex thing. So these two guys came along, I'm sure you guys have seen this in social media, Blowhive. They won our Design Award of the Year this year. This product is just, it's one of those things when you see it, you fall in love with it in an instant. From the outside, it doesn't look like a hell of a lot. It's got this pretty, rudimentary design in terms of having big screws sticking out of it, and it's all just timber. The really, really smart thing about this is what goes on the inside, these little cassettes. And if you look carefully there, they spent, I think, 5 or 6 years trying to perfect this. How do they crack the hive that allows the honey to then drip down and out of the beehive? I think the important lesson there is that they were following one design direction for literally 5 years, and Siva, the younger, the son who worked with his dad, woke up one morning and said, "I reckon we should just try and crack them horizontally instead of vertically." And the dad, Stu, he tells me the story. He said it took a hell of a lot for him to take 5 years worth of work and just push it off the table and go, "Let's follow that. That sounds like a pretty good way to do it." Coming back to that ideation process in design and that testing and that prototyping, this was their big breakthrough. The other amazing thing about this story was the crowdfunding campaign that they used. I've circled that there because their target was 70 grand. They wanted to raise $70,000 to try and get this thing into a prototype stage so they can actually prove it. They launched it online. Indiegogo was the crowdfunding platform. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but it was within about 10 minutes they'd raised $250,000. And when the campaign closed, it was $12.5 million. That's US dollars, by the way. And when you hear these guys talk, I've met them in person, the most humble, awesome blokes in the world. It's like, we had no idea what to do with all this money. And all of a sudden we had, we were like $12 million and all the thousands of orders. And they literally didn't know what to do. And thank goodness they engaged an industrial design consultancy, guys from Brisbane out of the Evolve Group, and they actually helped them structure the manufacturing process, structure the design of the business. They now employ well over 100 people. They are selling this product to, I think, 120 countries around the world, and it's just an amazing success story. One quick video so you can get a bit of a sneak peek into what makes this thing so amazing.
As an inventor, you have these hopes and dreams, and the only thing that really keeps you going is being optimistic that yes, we can make this idea work. And to finally see it work after a decade of tinkering away in the shed with my dad was extraordinary.
First drops are pouring.
It's pouring in.
Our next big challenge was to take our invention to the world, and crowdfunding allowed us to do that in a way we never dreamt was possible. Suddenly, our small campaign turned into a community of passionate beekeepers all around the world, now numbering over 35,000 and growing.
It's amazing to see their enthusiasm for beekeeping and their willingness to learn and to share knowledge.
One small act, right, of saying, if you need to try bees, then it opens up not just this world of bees, but it's sort of a window into being more connected to nature in a much larger way.
I thought it was an awesome invention. I've seen how typical beekeeping takes place, how harvesting honey happens, and I thought I didn't want to do it that way. I'd rather try something different.
One of the coolest things I've ever done in my life was pull out the first frame and crawl into bees.
Honey harvesting is such a pain, and it's a tremendous amount of work, and it makes a huge mess. It's very destructive to the bees. It's a kind of a disaster, no matter what you do, no matter how hard you plan, you just end up with, honey everywhere. So just actually just have it pour out of the side of the hive into a jar and skip all of that mess is amazing.
When we got the first flyby going, it was obvious that it was such a peaceful and entertaining experience that every time we get honey, we have to make sure all our friends come over and experience it. It's really special.
Right, so I'm just conscious of time, so I'm going to just speed through the next couple of slides. Obviously, they were ecstatic, they could not believe that the judges picked this product over, we had Tesla into the Powerwall and Google and Microsoft and some of the biggest companies in the world, and everyone gravitated to this product just because of the fact that it was not only a representation of great design, but for that bigger problem that they were also trying to solve. Pollution, as I said, in that, so that world map of all the little dots around it, this is an issue that, whether you believe in climate change or not, it's real. What could we do in terms of trying to reduce our reliance on combustion engines? And, big, big polluter of our planet comes out of these exhaust pipes. We gave the Design Award of the Year to Tesla in 2015, so last year. An example of a product, before FlowHive came along, this is my favourite thing I've ever seen in the entire world, because has anyone driven a Tesla? No? Yeah, you get, there's an interior shot here, I think. Everything about this car has been so incredibly well designed. And again, coming back to that, those earlier slides where I told you about, technology and business and people, you don't need... You get into this thing and it's probably the most technologically advanced thing you've ever seen in your life. You don't feel it. Everything has just been so beautifully designed. Elon Musk from Tesla has got this great quote. He says, if a product needs an instruction manual, it's flawed. It's fundamentally flawed from the day ago. And I completely agree. And not only, from a design point of view, but from a performance perspective as well. I think their latest P90 Model S goes to 0-100 in 2.5 seconds, and you can get a 500-kilometer range out of that. So that's faster than some of the most expensive sports cars on the planet. And I think that the message there again is that they made electric cars sexy. And we see Priuses around the place. They just haven't had the appeal that a Tesla has. The incredible thing about Tesla is that there is a grand plan. Not everyone can afford a $130,000 Model S. And as you would probably know, they're bringing out a Model X, a Model 3, and trying to get the price down. They've also released all their patents to the automotive world, which I think is an incredible thing as well. This is a map of all the charge stations from the east to the west coast of the US. Again, you buy a Tesla, you don't pay for your power to charge your car. So he's genuinely trying to reduce our reliance on fossil fuels. It's just incredible. The one little dot there that you see in Mexico is the only charge station. I think it's probably got something to do with Donald Trump's wall across Mexico. This is what these charge stations look like. Again, just a brilliant example of not only a product design, but a systematic approach to design. The Tesla Powerwall, as I mentioned, that was entered this year, and we gave that a good design award. I think there's a Model 2 of this Powerwall that's come out as well. And more recently, the solar tiles, which basically you can build a house, put these solar powered tiles on your house, and be completely 100% off the grid. How cool is that? No more energy bills. Your solar roof tiles are storing all the energy in your Tesla Powerwall, which charges your motor car. You know, that's not a pipe dream. That can actually happen. You guys may have seen the Gigafactory that's been built in the US. Elon Musk has been quoted in a movie with Leonardo DiCaprio, if you guys have seen this, and he says that if there were 100 gigafactories built today, we can completely eliminate fossil fuels and our reliance on fossil fuels altogether. He obviously doesn't have the capacity to build 100, he's building one, he's building two, he's building three. But it is actually possible when you think about it in that context. I'm going to just skip through two more examples and I want to quickly go through them. So anemia, this is when your blood cells in your body kind of look like that instead of the normal one. Believe it or not, anemia is something that is suffered by just over 3 billion people, so half our population suffer from anemia. There is a particular area in Cambodia where the rates of anemia are higher than anywhere else in the world. I mean, there's a gentleman who out of Canada who went and did his PhD research. He wanted to understand why. This is, again, you know, it's like trying to pick your favourite child. There's so many projects that are just amazing. This one is incredible, and I'll tell you why. So he found out that it had something to do with, well, it had a lot to do with the diets of these children living in Cambodia. They were eating fish, they were eating rice, and they were cooking out of aluminium pots and pans, right, because they couldn't afford iron pots. And believe it or not, you actually get quite a high level of iron from cooking with an iron pot. I didn't know that. Cook your steak in an iron pot, the iron actually dissolves into that steak, and that's how you get to have your iron. So he had this brainwave idea, and he said, well, imagine if I can take that same iron pot and turn it into a little block and then distribute it to these people living in these villages and get them to cook with this little iron block, and then the iron would dissolve and they'd get their level of iron, and hopefully anemia would, you know, their rates of anemia would drop. So he went and he got a sponsor on board, and I think he made about 1,000 of these little iron blocks, about the size of a Lego block, distributed them to the local village, came back 6 months later and found that no one was cooking with them. kids were playing marbles with them, they were being used as door stoppers, and he thought, you know, the problem, he's identified the problem, he's come up with a solution, but it's the wrong solution. So he worked with an industrial designer, and they came up with this, called the Lucky Iron Fish. It's the same block of steel, it's just been moulded into the shape of a fish. The really, really cool thing about this is that it's no ordinary fish. Through that research process and understanding, the empathising with you know, who they were designing for, they found that this particular fish was a symbol of luck in Cambodia. That particular insignia meant luck. So he's using the same piece of iron, but just giving it to them in a different way. A brilliant, brilliant example there. He's come back, I think, a year later. People are cooking with him because it's not about now we're going to solve the problem of anemia. This is luck. If we put this thing in our food, we're going to be lucky. And he's managed to try and solve that problem. This is just a very short clip that shows he not only thought about the design of the actual fish, but the manufacturing process as well, so that he allowed locals to make the fish themselves, simple sand casting process. The packaging was made by locals as well, and he's, I think it's about $5, you can get these, he's trying to get the price right down, and that's, one fish is enough to give a family sufficient iron for a 10-year period, you know, it's bloody brilliant. So again, that won our Social Innovation Award in the Good Design Awards this year, and I absolutely love that, because it's just, you know, without design that would have not happened. And then finally, almost on the home stretch, garbage, as I mentioned, is a really, really, it's a pretty gross picture. You guys may have read this, a lot of research now showing that the levels of plastic in our ocean is actually going to be to such an extent we won't be able to reverse that process at all. There's going to be so much plastic in our ocean. How do we try and turn that tide? Plastic discarded fishing nets, so big commercial fishing operators unfortunately do this. Instead of taking their old nets and chucking them back in to be discarded, they just drop them on the ocean floor. So they do horrible damage to our ocean floor and cause all sorts of havoc. There's a company that came along based in the US called Interface, and they found that fishing nets actually have the highest concentration of nylon. That's what fishing nets have to be strong, right? So they designed an entire ecosystem to work with local villages and to fish, to basically harvest all these discarded fishing nets off the ocean floor, designed a process to recycle them and turn them into commercial carpets. Incredibly strong because they're all made of nylon and very, very hard wearing. I just think, again, you know, that's a design problem that was looked at from a completely different perspective and has resulted in not only a commercially successful outcome, but it's also doing good for the planet. I told you that I was going to share a story about the refugee crisis and design's role in that. This is one of the biggest refugee camps in the world in Kenya. And the United Nations have an enormous issue on their hands to try and supply housing to people in areas like this. The traditional tent structure is about 5,000 US bucks for one of them. They last about 6 months. One sandstorm goes through and they're gone. People don't live in these refugee camps for 6 months. Sometimes they live there for 3, 4, 5 years. So there's a designer from IKEA who actually saw this documentary. I've met this guy, he's just absolutely unreal. He saw a documentary around the refugee crisis and he was designing flatpack furniture for IKEA and he thought, man, I've got to do something different with my life. And he put together a whole conceptual plan to come up with flatpack housing for refugees. He presented it to the IKEA Foundation. So this is a foundation that funds big projects like this. He got all the funding. And it won our World Design Impact Prize. This is now being rolled out across refugee camps. It's supported by United Nations and UNHCR as well. Again, just, you know, when you talk about design actually helping the refugee crisis, this is the kind of story that you want to leave people with. And then finally, water. I mentioned, you know, this issue around water. I love this diagram. I don't know if anyone's seen this, but it just illustrates how delicate our planet is with regards to water. That big blob there represents all the fresh, all the water on our planet. 97% of that is from our oceans, right? So just sort of visually, you kind of go, wow, that's pretty, you know, that the little dot next to it is the fresh drinking water that we have on this planet. And it's less than 1% of it is actually usable. So when you see a picture like that, you go, wow, you know, water is going to be a big, big problem if it isn't already. Here's a project I'm sure you guys have seen called the Life Straw. I think it's the one on the left is actually a product that was designed in Melbourne, and I throw it up there just as a contrast because it uses the exact same filtration process, but this is filtering clean drinking water that we can pretty much drink out of the tap for a developed world. But on the other side, the Life Straw is solving a much, much bigger problem. A quick story just on that Life Straw. The guy who came up with the idea struggled like hell to get venture capitalists and investors on board. He had the technology, he proved it, but he couldn't get anyone interested. So he organised a media event and he went to a public toilet in London and stuck it in a dunny and actually drank all the water out of the dunny, and straight away had investors calling all over him. So you kind of have to do that. And again, that's, I think they're about $6 or $7, and one Life Straw can give someone enough water, fresh water to drink for a whole year. And you know, again, the volume of those things, as they start to increase, the price will then come down. And finally, an amazing project, again, that received our World Design Impact Prize, a project called Waka Water. This is a system that uses nets to take moisture out of the atmosphere and turn it into fresh drinking water. There's a close-up of what that then looks like. Again, just incredibly ingenious. There's a short little video and then I'm done.
My name is Arturo Vittori and I'm an architect designer. Over the last 3 years, we have been working on a project called Waka Water. Waka Water is a philosophy that is looking at environments and different possibilities the idea of the project came out from visiting a small village called Dorset in Ethiopia, realizing these incredible issues, seeing children and women walking for kilometers and kilometers every day in order to bring some water home. Parker water is represented now by a tower that is going up to the sky to collect moisture from the air and to bring it down by ground to the people. We have a holding structure which is made in this case out of bamboo. There is an inner mesh that is harvesting, collecting the water by condensation, and then there is a diffunder, and then a reservoir that is containing the water. Each tower is capable to provide the community with 100 liters of water every day. And this water is potable. The idea is to have a structure simple to construct on site. The entire tower is very light. It's almost 80 kilograms and is 20 meters high. So that was the big challenge, how to make it possible to build without scaffolding, without machinery, only by working by hand. But in order to achieve this, the real technology and difficulty has been in the design part. So for me, the cutting-edge technology in the project is in the software. The design is basically parametric. Once we have designed the shape, we can improve it and implement it very easily without redesigning it again. So in a few seconds, we already have another option. An important part of the project is the idea that it's an open source content. The local community will be trained how to make it. And they will be free to repeat it as much as they like.
So, that is it. I want to leave you with a quote that I think is relevant to everything that I've been talking about, and that is that design is too important to be left to designers. I absolutely believe in that, and I think the encouraging thing for me is that we've managed to just nudge the narrative around what design is into a different direction, albeit internationally at a very slow pace, but I'm hoping that that narrative starts to stick with our education institutions, and our future designers out there start to think about design in this context and not pop out into the industry wanting to design beautiful kettles and toasters, which we all need, but these are some bigger problems that I think the true power of design can actually be leveraged for. So I hope you enjoyed it, and thank you very much. I'm sorry I went over time a little bit.